everybody. Good morning, everybody. If you would stand with me all over the room this morning. If you're out in the lobby, go ahead and make your way on into the auditorium. We're going to get prepared for worship this morning. It's a really special day for us here. Obviously, we have our Build It offering that we're going to be taking up at the end of service today. But before we do, I want you to see, we need to get into a particular posture for today's service. And I want you to see this all as a form of worship. Giving is a form of worship. And there are certain days and certain times where we set aside times to put an emphasis on that, and we've done that. And so this morning, I really want you to think about the act of giving, and as we start in worship, I want you to think about you just giving your heart to Jesus all over again this morning. Whether you've done that, whether you've said, hey, like, my heart is yours, Jesus, or you've never done that before, I just want you to focus on giving your heart to Him all over again and letting worship kind of come from that place. And so if you would this morning, would you just stretch your hands to Jesus with me all over the room? Father, we just thank you this morning for your presence, Lord. We thank you for who you are this morning, Lord, and we just set aside today to come and worship you. We set aside this morning to come and glorify you. Lord, there is nobody like you. There is nobody like you, Jesus. There's none beside you, Jesus. There's truly nobody like you. There's nobody that we would rather worship. And Lord, we give our heart to you this morning. We give our heart to you this morning, Jesus. You have our attention, Lord. You have our focus, Lord. Every part of us, Lord, we just come and lay at your feet this morning. There is nobody like you, Jesus. We love you this morning, Lord. We praise you today. We worship you this morning, Lord.
Yeah. turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can.
You turn graves, hey.
You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the
sing this real loud. Thank you.
For the promises you've kept and every need you've met. And Lord, I'm so grateful you were with me every step. And I never will forget when I think of how you blessed me, how your hand has never let me go. Never let me. You have been so good to me, and God, I can't believe how you love me. What a friend you have been, so good to me, and God, I can't believe how you love me. What a friend you have been.
Faithful.
stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. And even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop.
Cause you are my one.
'cause you are my one thing. You are my one thing, and I don't want anyone else, and I don't need anything else, 'cause you are my one thing. You are my one thing, and I don't want anyone else, and I don't need anything else, 'cause you are my one thing. You are my one thing, 'cause I don't want anyone else, and I don't need anything else, 'cause you are my, you are my one thing, and I don't want anyone else, and I don't need anything else. You are my one, you are my one thing. You are my one thing. You are my one thing. You are my one thing.
Service. I've really just been sensing the Spirit saying a lot of things to me personally, but I feel like I have something for the room. I feel like I'm hearing this a lot. I feel like I'm hearing language that would imply that maybe some people in the room feel really stuck. You feel like you're stuck, and it's almost like you're in like a... It's almost like you're in quicksand, and you're trying really hard to get unstuck on your own. And you like, the harder you fight, the tireder you get, and you don't really understand why you can't get unstuck. And I want to just offer you maybe a word of wisdom in this moment. The harder you fight in seasons where you feel like you're stuck or you feel like you're drowning, you just get tired. You do not get free. You just get tired. You do not get free. One of the biggest theological flaws in the church at large is that we use language that tells you that you need to try harder and do better. And when you do that, even if you did try harder and even if you did do better and that made you free, then you got yourself free. And that won't last. Willpower and discipline is good. Willpower and discipline will only last for so long. The only thing that can set you free and keep you free is love. The only thing that can set you free and keep you free is love. And it's not that you love God more. It's not you try to love God more. It's that you come into this realization that it does not matter where you're at or how you feel or what you've done or what you're feeling inside. He is after your heart. He is after your heart. I love a lot of times that we sing songs in church about God having victory. And can I tell you this? He will also have victory over you. He will have victory over the false self. He will beat the part of you and come out victorious over the part of you that doesn't feel like that you are lovable. He fights that part too. We love when God is fighting our battles for us. But I feel there's some people in the room today that God is fighting that false self that lives within you. He's fighting that self that says, I feel like I need to do more and try harder and be enough and all of this. And he's saying, just stop. Just stop. Stop trying to measure up to standards that God never tried to get you to hit in the first place. The only standard is love. And if freedom doesn't come by love, it's not real freedom. If breakthrough comes by you striving and trying and all of that harder, it's not real breakthrough. If it doesn't come by love, it's not real. And so in this moment, I want us to keep in this flow. And I want you to sing this song. But I want you to stop trying to work harder, do more, be more, all of that. And I want you to let God love you. I want you to let the Spirit begin to work in you and let Him love you. Let Him see the parts of you that you're afraid to show Him. Let Him see the parts of you that you're embarrassed about. Let Him see the parts of you that you're confused about. Let Him see the parts of you that you don't know why you can't get free from. Let Him see all of it, man. He's not scared of any of it. He's not scared of any of it. He's not afraid of any of it. And so, Lord, we just invite you in this moment and we just ask you to love us. We ask you to make us so unbelievably aware of your love. The parts of us that we feel like we need to do something to change, Lord, would you come in and touch those parts and change them if you want to. If you want to.
just want you, Jesus.
I want to so move on from this moment, but I really just don't feel like I can. Before I'm going to say one more thing, because I think it's something that someone in the room, maybe you need to hear this morning. We have been conditioned in our society to believe things about ourselves that are not true and that God never said. One of my favorite things about the Bible, and I really cannot wait to dive into more of this soon, but one of my favorite things about the Bible is that that's our story. The Bible is our story because the Bible is a story about Jesus, and we are in Jesus. And every part of Jesus' story is also where we find our real story. But I feel like this morning, there is a part of the story of the Bible that we get so unbelievably wrong. In ancient Near Eastern literature, which is Genesis, there is a particular style of writing called Mesopotamian myths. And shocker, that's what Genesis is. Not a myth in the fact that it's not real, but in a myth in the way that it's telling you a story. And there are hundreds of creation stories that open up just like Genesis' creation story does. Opens up with creation, right? And as God is getting ready, our creation story, what makes ours unique and what sets ours apart is that when God gets ready to create the world, he creates the seas, the water, all of the stuff, right? Plants, animals, giraffes, horses, whatever. Creates them all. And he gets to the very end. And he says, let us make man in our image. Let us make man in our image. And we are created. Human beings are created. And I think it's such a beautiful thing, because then God goes on this kind of kick where he's like, everything I made is good. Plants are good. The animals are good. And he gets to us and he says, they are very good. They are very good. And I think some of you need to know this morning, you were not born with a wicked nature. You were born with a very good nature. And the world, the way that the Bible lays this out, our story through the world, is as we journey through life, life dehumanizes us. Life happens to us. Sin happens to us. And it makes us believe lies about ourselves that would tell ourselves that we are not very good. We are not very good. That is a version of the gospel that people have used to capitalize on people's emotions. They tell you how bad you are, then they call you to an altar to get you scream and repent, and they just do that over and over and over again. In reality, what the gospel is that you were made in the image of God. You are very good. You have a good nature. Sin has happened to you, and it's messed all of that good up. It's messed it all up. And we live our lives trying to get back in touch with that very good nature. You hating yourself, self-hatred, is not part of that very good nature. Depression is not part of that very good nature. Anxiety is not part of that very good nature. lust is not part of that very good nature. You are made in the image of God. What Moses was doing when he was writing Genesis, this is where his mind was. I am leading a bunch of Egyptians, and the only way that they know how to think is like an Egyptian slave. So what do I need to tell them to make sure that they can live free from this? Oh, I need to tell them our creation story, that they're made in the image of God and they're very good and they were never born for this slavery. That's what Moses is doing. And I just feel like there's someone in the room this morning that you need to hear that you were never born for slavery. You were never born for Egypt. You were never born for darkness. You were born very good, made in the image of God to bear His image. That's how you were born. You weren't wicked upon birth. Imagine a theology that says that, right? Imagine a theology that says babies are wicked. Yeah. It's really strange. It's really weird. Whatever. I won't get off on that kick. But you, some of you in this room, you've been sinned against in all sorts of different ways. And I'm here just to tell you this morning, you are very good. You are made in the image of God. You are made in the likeness of God. And repentance, literally is the word metanoia. And it means to change your mind. It doesn't mean to stop doing what you're doing. It means to change your mind. Change your mind about what? Who you think you are in God. Because when you go from a world of I'm very bad and wicked to I'm very good, all the behavior issues take care of themselves. When you go from I'm very bad to I'm made in the image of God, this is how you start living. An image bearer, full of love and compassion and mercy and grace and empathy. And so this morning, if everybody would you just stand back to your feet with me? Because I just want to pray over this morning. I feel this so strongly, and I was not planning on this today, but it just is what it is. We kind of go with the Spirit wherever He leads. If you would you just, everyone in the room, close your eyes. And if you are struggling this morning with some of the things that I hit on, would you just slip your hand up really quick? Father, right now in Jesus' name, we declare over them that they are very good. They are your beloved children, and you are pleased with them. You are pleased with them. You are in love with them. You are in love with them. Despite of their behavior, despite of where they're at in life, your love doesn't relent. It doesn't stop. It doesn't hold up. I heard a theologian say this one time, and I think this is really beautiful, that Jesus took a beating by religion so that we did not have to be beat by religion. Because what religion does is it beats you down. And He took a beating so that you didn't have to, and so that we don't have to. And so this morning, I see this picture of, it's almost like you've been taking a beating and you are tired of being hit and you are tired of feeling unworthy. And I just see that stopping. I see that coming to an end. And so, Lord, we just thank you this morning that you took a beating by religion so we didn't have to be beat by religion, so that we could live in love and union with you and let everything flow from that place. Just take a deep breath in right where you're at this morning. Just take a deep breath. Sometimes I think you just need to hear the Spirit say, everything's going to be okay. You're going to make it, and I'm going to be here right with you. So, Lord, we thank you that you are God with us. You are God with us. You are God in us. Lord, we thank you this morning for the work that you're doing in our heart. God, we trust that you never stop working. You never stop working. You see us, you know us, you hear us, and you never stop working. Lord, we thank you this morning for your presence in this room and the work that you're doing among these people. And God, I pray that you would just continue this work. I pray whatever this, your word says that he who began a good work is faithful to complete it. Lord, I pray that you would see whoever needs this through the end of their work, the work that you're doing in them, the work that they are doing themselves, and that they would be full of life and joy and peace, and they would live in union with you and in love with you forever and ever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Can you put your hands together for Jesus all over the room this morning? You know, one of the things that I think I decided a long time ago was if I have a certain way that I feel like that today should go, usually God like plays these little tricks with me and interrupts them because I like things to go a certain way, and he's just like, eh, it's not going to go that way. Yeah. And so, yeah, thanks God for inducing some stress on me this morning. Thanks. Anyways, so glad that you're here. So thankful that you are with us today. If you're watching online or you're a guest in the room, we are so glad that you are watching or that you're here with us. Resting Place Church, can we give it up for those people who are watching online or in the room today? We love you. So glad that you are here. I make this commitment to everyone in our church that visits our church, that maybe you're watching online, you're thinking about visiting our church. I say this, if just give us 3 weeks, we want to get to know you, we want to let you to get to know us, and if you hate us at the end of that 3 weeks, I will help you find a church here in the area. I will help you find a body of believers to belong to, because I believe that everyone who professes Jesus needs to belong to a body of believers. There is a work that he does in us through all of that. And so glad that you're here this morning. So thankful that you are here. Resting Place Church, it's time for offering. This is our normal tithe and our normal offering. So the build it will come at the very end of service today. So this is our normal tithe and offering this morning. I've just been thinking, we are in a really, really good spot in our church, in the history of our church. And I believe God is setting us up for something really special. I believe that he's doing something really great in our church body, in our church community. I was able to share this a couple weeks ago, but we've been able to give away around 20% of our income this year to those who are in need. And can I just share something with you? That is not normal. That is not normal. I never want to make light of the things that happen here that are uncommon that are just, they are common to us, but they are uncommon in the span of the church world. Most churches do not give away 20% of their income. They don't. Some churches aren't able to give away 20% of their income. And there is a reason why that we are able to do that, and it's because of you. It's because of your generosity week in and week out. You being faithful to give and tithe and offering week in and week out. And we're able to do more. I believe that even this year, I believe God has multiplied seed where we needed it multiplied, where we needed it. And God has done really, really cool stuff all year in our church because of your giving. And it's touching the world around us. One of the things that I was thinking about this last night, Jake, after you said this, I thought about what something you said for about 2 hours after you said it. You didn't even know that you said it. Yeah. Thanks, Jake. But Jake has some family members who are about to be put on staff at a very, very, very well-known church in Florida. And Jake is not leaving, so this is not that. So just calm down. That I know of. So, yeah. You're on this stage with me, Wes, and Jordan, Gentry, and Jansen. You will not get off the stage. My shoulder's not healed, but I can put you in an arm bar, okay? Anyways, Jake was sharing something with me last night that I just thought was so unbelievably encouraging and something that I feel like is supposed to happen at our church. There was a church in Pensacola, Florida in the 90s that had this, massive move of God. When I say millions of people, I mean millions of people, not hundreds of thousands, millions of people. And his family members were interviewing for a job there, and this is what the pastor told them. He said, when millions of people came through Pensacola in the 90s, we were able to touch the world, but we never touched our community. And a lot of times what ministries can get focused on is touching the world and not touching the people who are actually at arm's length. One of the things about this church that we will always do, we will touch the people who are at arm's length first before we touch the people who are hundreds of thousands of miles away. And we have just such big vision that I'm going to let Katie share about in a little bit. But I just want to thank you. Like, as we're winding down towards the end of the year, for your giving, because we have been able to be a church that touches the world around us. We've been able to be that church. And so, thank you. So let's give this morning. Let's get prepared to give. And so there's 4 ways that you can give. You can go online to restingplace.co to give. You can give by cash or check on your way out today. You can go on the Church Center app to give, and or you can text to give, 84321, any amount to that, and you'll get a link back, and it'll give there. We're going to make some declarations over our finances this morning. So if you would, stand with me all over the room, and then we're going to let you sit down for a long time. Anyways, so let's make these declarations together this morning. Father, I declare today that I am a tither and a giver. Because of my obedience to your word, I receive prosperity in every area of my life. I thank you that I have more than enough in all things. You've given me the power to get wealth. You meet all my needs according to your riches and glory, and you multiply every seed I sow. You rebuke the devourer for my sake. The windows of heaven are opened over my life, and your blessing makes rich and adds no sorrow to it. Like Joseph, I prosper wherever I go and in every situation because you are with me. Father, thank you for meeting all of my financial needs, that I may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and accomplish your purposes in the earth. Shout the next word. All right, take a seat this morning. Get ready to watch the video.
Good morning, Resting Place Church. I'm Pastor Anna, and I just want to take a minute to welcome you to church today. If you're a first-time guest, welcome. We're so glad you're here today. Scan the QR code on the seat in front of you and fill out that online Connect card. And then swing by Connect Point after service to get a free gift. We would love to meet you after service in the lobby. If you're watching online, thanks for tuning in. Our challenge is that you would come and join us and worship together with us in person. We would love to meet you. Everybody, keep your attention right here. We've got some fun things going on at church that we want to make you aware of.
Resting Place Kids is hosting our Pajama Month the entire month of December. We want to invite you to join us for our Christmas service, He Is With Us, Our Christmas Story, on December the 17th. Mark your calendars for our Christmas gala on December the 16th from 5:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. You can sign up on the Church Center app. Dinner and childcare will be provided for this event, so please make sure that you mark who will be attending so that we can plan accordingly. There will be no Sunday service on December the 24th or the 31st here at the church. Please take this time to spend time with your families through this Christmas season. Our new Genesis series is coming up starting in January. Make sure that you follow us on the Bible app so that you can prepare to follow along with our study plan and our weekly readings. We will also have notebooks available for you to purchase for this upcoming series.
Thanks for tuning in. Once again, we're so glad you're here. Now let's prepare our hearts for a powerful message.
Check. There we go. We're on. Well, good morning, everybody. They're moving chairs on the stage this morning because this morning is going to be a bit different. And I think it's good what we're about to do. And I'm excited about it. So I have some people that are going to be joining me this morning. Everybody give it up for Will Sargent in the building this morning. Katie Rains and Marissa LaRoe. All right. Well, welcome. Man of God, Will. Women of God, Marissa, Katie. Yeah. So really, what we wanted to do this morning is, today is our Build It offering. Yes, yes, yes. Today is our Build It offering. We are believing God for $50,000 just here in a few minutes, actually. And we're believing that He's going to do it. It's really cool. Just this week, I've had people call me and tell me numbers that they feel like God spoke to them to give. And I'm just so encouraged by how generous our church is. I am so encouraged. We're going to do this. We're going to build a building. It's going to happen. There are people who are just... in this season of life, it's like, man, they are really like asking those questions that I told y'all to ask this last week. Like, what can I afford? What can I sacrifice? And what is God asking me to give? And they're doing those things. And it is just so unbelievably encouraging to me. A couple just housekeeping things really quick. There is a basket out at Connect Point for you to drop your pledge cards. So we're going to be collecting those over the next 2 weeks. So if you didn't bring yours today, you can bring it next week. But please be sure that you bring it next week, whatever you're going to pledge over the next 3 years in our generosity campaign. If you're unfamiliar with kind of what we're doing, we are starting a generosity campaign today. like it starts today. And so we're believing to kick it off with a $50,000, us as a church giving $50,000 towards us building a building. And then for the next 3 years, we're asking you to pledge something above your normal tithe and offering that you give every week. Here is what absolutely cannot happen. Please let me clarify something really quick. Do not take your normal tithe and offering and pledge it towards the building. Because what you're going to have is, I'm going to tell you what's actually going to happen. This is like, I'm being as honest as I know how to be here. If that happens and we cannot sustain the church the way that it is, what happens is the church closes and our staff gets that as a severance package. That's what happens. You don't want that to happen, right? That's not what we're trying to do here, but I'm telling you what will happen if you're like, I've been tithing for a while now and I'm just going to quit doing that and give into the build it offering. We're like, we're going to be raising money for a building and not paying bills here, and then we ain't going to get nowhere. So do not take your normal tithe and offering and give it in this, right? Ask the Lord what you should do above your normal tithe and offering. This is above and beyond giving. This is not just normal, everyday, every Sunday giving. So it's important that I noted that, because I had a friend who did one of these, and it's like everybody just gave to this one fund. And it's like, he was like, wait, you can't do that. Like, we're not going to exist as a church if you keep doing that. So, but I just wanted to touch on that really quickly. And I have these three up here with me. So this is Will. Everybody give it up for Will one time. This is Katie. Everybody give it up for Katie. And Marissa. Everybody give it up for Marissa. Now, Timmy was supposed to be up here, but he had an emergency, and his little girl has the stomach virus, and it looks like that he has caught the stomach virus as well. But he did send me a long text message this morning and say, here's a couple things I would like you to share on my behalf. So I'm going to read those this morning. Oh, Jesus. Yeah. Great. In a good way. This church has transformed the life of my family. The vision, the people, and the purpose is what keeps us at Resting Place Church. We want to see the hungry fed, the broken made whole, and the widow be cared for. This is what it means to bring the kingdom of heaven to earth. My family has seen financial breakthrough in the last 2 years that isn't even explainable. And that is a result of sowing into the good ground here. We are pledging ourselves on top of our normal tithing because this building is just the start of watching Knoxville being transformed into the city that it's supposed to be, into the city that brings the kingdom of heaven to earth. This is going to be a house of restoring, replenishing, and relaunching the hurting and hopeless back into the earth and back into their purpose. Love you, bro. He was talking to me. But I want to stop talking for a second, and I want to give them the opportunity to share this morning. This is Will. You pass it to Marissa. She's going to go first. You'll have to cut the mic on too. This is Will, Katie, Marissa. Will and Marissa serve on our financial board here. Timmy also serves on our financial board here. And the reason that they all serve on our financial board, here's the number one reason. If they hear something stupid, they'll say no. It's the reason. You don't put yes men in important positions. Like, this isn't about my vision. This isn't about my vision. This was a unanimous yes vote from the financial board and the staff of our church. And Katie is our outreach director. That's why I actually asked her to get up here. But I want them to share just a little bit about why you are pledging, why you are here at this church, and what this church means to you, and why you're on board with this.
Okay. So, thanks, y'all. Thanks.
You got to hold the mic closer.
There
you go.
Okay.
You're good.
I was saved very young. I was 4. The way I describe it to people is that Jesus came and hugged me in a worship service. So I have spent my whole life in church, and I was raised in a family that for generations was very active in ministry. And I think that even in childhood, God forms you to do the things that he has for you to do later in life. And one of those times for me was when I was about 12 or 13. Our church had a, like, after-school care, and then in the summer, it was a K through fifth grade, like, all-day daycare. And I can remember the children's pastor, who was also the director of the daycare, talking to other adults all the time about, like, he would be reprimanded in meetings because he would take partial payments from the single moms. And his response to them was always, well, you come down here and look the single mom who's crying in the eye and tell them that they have to find childcare by tomorrow. And that's been over half my life now ago, and it has stuck with me this whole time. And so it just really came to the like forefront of my mind when Cole was talking about childcare a couple weeks ago, because that was a church, and all they cared about was profit. And kind of continuing through my life, seeing that trend over and over. By the time I got to about 23, I was kind of like, is this really all the church has to offer? Because it's pointless. Like, I had no reason to be here. And I was praying things like, Jesus, I'm having a hard time finding you here. So where are you? And his answer to me was to come be a part of this community. When we had the name change, Cole called me. And before that, we had a conversation when he was trying to figure out if we were even going to continue as a church at all. And I said, well, Cole, if you shut the church down, then I guess I'm going to be in your living room come Sundays, because I don't have anywhere else to go. Like, there's nowhere else. There's nowhere else that I would trust for the like my children's foundation with Jesus to be formed, to help me form it for my own formation. And there's nowhere else that I know of that has a stirring down on the inside of us collectively as a whole to do something about the problems we see around us. Because, you know, I can see them, but I can't fix them on my own. But what I can do is be a part of a community of people who will collectively pull our resources and do something that makes lasting change. Because I don't have a doubt that whatever God tells us to do, that he will already have people in this community, that when he tells us to do something, that there will be people here that says, hey, that's what's down on the inside of me to fix. I can do that. My favorite Christian voice is Emily P. Freeman. And one of the things that she talks about when making decisions is to follow the arrows, because God doesn't really lead us in a way that we can see how things all connect together. But if we look for the arrows and follow them, we'll get to where he needs us to be.
That's good.
And so I'm just going to share my family's personal reasons for our arrows in pledging this. And it's because I get mad when Cole reads all those statistics.
I read them to make you mad.
Yeah, yeah.
holy anger. Be angry, but sin not.
Because there is no reason why those should be people's realities. Especially when you think about how many churches surround us. I can't count the churches between here and there because it makes me mad now. I'm like, I can't, like, drive. I live 45 minutes away. So if I drive, start there and drive all the way to here, I can't. Yeah. Hang on, my Face ID is broke. I gotta put the password in. Okay.
Marissa's got that low power mode on. It'll cut off on you.
Yeah. I don't like to charge my phone as little
stewardship.
As possible.
That's what it is.
And those are just statistics on the hungry. So, like, we don't even have all the other needs that are around us. Because we came here as a desperate last attempt to be a part of a church, and God exceeded that and completely put me back together in this community. And I know that that is a lot of the stories of the other people here. And I want to make sure there's a safe place for when people need that place to be put back together, that they come here and that can happen for them. There is such a passion here for the next generation because, you know, when I came here, everything that I knew about following Jesus was burnt away. And I say burnt away because I fully believe he came and used his fire and burned it. And it was just... because I was that person that Cole was talking about this morning. Everything was about how hard do I have to strive to make sure that I'm okay with him, that he loves me. So when all of that was burned away, though, the only thing I had left was my foundation with my relationship with Jesus as a child. And so that, for me, is a top priority because if I didn't have that, I would not be here. And lastly, because on Throwback Sunday, I stood back there and sobbed. Because the last time I sung those songs, I was a teenager. And now being firmly planted in adulthood, it just hit me like a ton of bricks that, like, it's my responsibility now to move forward in what God has us to do. And eventually I'll hand that to my children. And I can't think of a greater honor than that.
It's good. You should give it up. I know we kind of talked about a little bit of, like, the next generation this morning. Or she did, not me. This is just, like, so cool. Like, I had someone come up to me this morning. And they were like, my kid wants to give in this offering. My kid wants to give in this offering. You know how big of a deal that is? Marissa said, give me the mic back.
This morning on the way to church, I was telling the kids that I was nervous about being up here because I think it's important you tell children when you're nervous and that you're doing it anyway. And so we're talking about that because, you know, Arthur, he's my oldest, he's 7. And he said, well, I wouldn't be nervous. I'd be brave. And I said, well, you can be nervous and brave at the same time. And so I told him what I was up here talking about, that we're asking for money so that we can help people who are hungry. I used hunger as the main example. I said, because people shouldn't be hungry. And they all three, I have three, they're 7, 5, and 3, almost 4, started coming up with ideas. What can we do to help that? What if we did a food shoot that came up from the roof and we could shoot it down to people? And what if we had a little...
I like that. Yeah. Well, food shoot.
Yeah, food shoot. And they're like, and they just kept having idea after idea. And I felt such confirmation that we're on the right track from that because it's like immediately what they said was, well, let's just do this and let's fix it.
I like that. So I think something that you hear there is, I mean, obviously, I'm not going to elaborate too much because it speaks for itself. But we are building something, and this is what I want you to know. You are going to help build something that will outlast you. It's going to last longer than you're going to last. It's going to last longer than I even think it's going to last. There is such a stirring in me to include the next generation in what we're doing. Because I know they make up 22% of our world, but they hold 100% of our future. They're going to be leading this one day. They're going to be up here one day. Someone in the next generation is going to be sitting in this seat doing this one day. And it's going to be because of this today. And I think it's so important that we see that and we know that. Katie, tell us a little bit about...
I don't want to hear any laughing, whoever just giggled.
Hold the mic closer, Katie.
Tell me the questions again.
Yeah.
first time with the mic.
Yeah. Why has this church meant what it's meant to your family, and what excites you the most about giving?
So we have been at this church in January, this coming January 2024, for 3 years. And I think, and it's so funny because we didn't know yet that I was actually going to be up here with them last night, but we were on the way home last night, and for whatever reason, I thought to myself, the two greatest things that have ever sharpened me and happened to me and made me better is, number one, meeting my children when they were in foster care and adopting them, and number two, being a part of this church. Those two reasons alone are the two things that have put me in my place today, that have given me the maturity that I have, that I still have lots of ways to go, but that I have now. It's given me the perspective that I have, and being with Cole and Emily, and he laughs at me, and Brandon, and everybody at this church. I came into this church a much less mature, just kind of lost, whatever, however old I was, 27-year-old. And now I stand here today with this outlook and this ability to dive into human chaos and the burden. Cole introduced me to Rowan Williams' book, Being Christian, and it says to be Christian, to be like Jesus, is to be immersed in human chaos and to feel the burden of those around us. And that's what this church has done to me. It's made me acutely aware of the need of my neighbor. It's made me acutely aware of the needs of my friends that surround me. And I'm thankful for the opportunity to be the outreach director, because I get to put that into direct action. And we have been, me and my husband, JoJo, we have been immensely blessed. When we started with this church, I was still in grad school, and he was working at a company that was owned by my dad, and my dad really didn't appreciate nepotism, so the salary was modest.
Yeah.
And I had just given up my good salary to go back to school, and it was tough. And we looked at each other and we were like, you know what, we're gonna give. If it's painful, we're gonna give. And I looked at the annual that we were giving, and I was like, oh, this is gonna be painful. And but we gave it, and joyful, and it just became a habit. And I can tell you now that we have been so unbelievably blessed, and we have put, both here with our giving and in just our lives with people, we see a need, we meet a need, period. We see a need, we meet a need, and that's something that we have woven into our life, and something that Pastor Cole has taught me, and something that Pastor Casey also taught me when he was here, and I continue to be taught just by friendships with everybody in this room, is that you see a need and you meet a need. And I know that deeply, more deeply than I would have ever known before. So this church has given me more than I could ever even begin to say. It has meant more to me. It has taught more to me. It has given me so much and has taught me about the need of my neighbor and how I can meet that. And I do want to say, just looking forward to the new building and the types of things that we will be able to do as far as, since I have the outreach, Cole had given the statistics, and I don't have those in front of me, but we're familiar with those, the food statistics, the hunger, the poverty rate in Tennessee, which is very high comparably to the USA's rate. But we see just from the Thanksgiving give back, when we talked about the fact that we had to cut the wait list off because we had a finite need that we could meet, that they were rolling in minute by minute by minute by minute, people desperate for food, desperate for help, desperate for a resource. And so the need is so unbelievably palpable. And if you don't know the people and you're not immersed in it, you don't see it as much. But me, because I'm outward facing to the public. Number one, I work with a pediatric population, and you see a lot there. But number two, people have my information from this church. So they email me, they text me, they call me. Hey, what are y'all doing for Christmas? What can I do here? Here. The need is so great. And we are going to meet the need of the adults, of the children with this new building. And I'm telling you right now, and y'all have experienced it, but there is nothing more fulfilling than seeing somebody be met by what you sacrifice. There is no amount too big. There is no sacrifice too big that you won't feel the most incredible sense of accomplishment and Jesus, like he's standing in front of you when you see somebody who didn't have something now because of something you did. It is absolutely earth-shattering, and there is nothing else like it to know that we met that need and they are changed and they feel Jesus because of us.
It's good. It's really good. I think one of the things that the reason that we have a financial board at this church is because if it were up to myself and our outreach director, we would give away all of our money and we wouldn't have any. It's really, me and Katie have been talking back and forth, and like honestly, like I threw out a number yesterday. I have a friend in Florida. And they just gave away like 15,000 pounds of food, right? And I'm just thinking, in my mind, I'm like, I called him and I was like, how much that cost? And he told me. And I was like, and there's no reason why we could give that amount of food away. This is not an exaggeration. If we did not have rent here, we could give that amount of food away, 15,000 pounds of food away, 4 days a week. 4 days a week. So, like, people who don't have groceries, like, that's where they'd come get them. Right? Like Marissa, yes, through the chute, through the grocery chute, the vision of Arthur. And it's like, and hey, we can make it happen now. Like, Katie says, we're going to. Yeah. So I think it's important to know, like, when she says that we had to cut the wait list off at the Thanksgiving give back, this is not an exaggeration. It opened at 8. It closed at 8:30. Had to close it. Had to close it at 8:30. Because people are just like, we need help. God does not put you in a region or in a city or in a position ever so that you can have status. He does it for service. And we will not use our building for status. It's going to be nice. It's going to be a home. It's going to be where some of your kids get married. It's going to be where some of your kids have baby showers one day. Tatum said amen. Tatum, we're going to have to send you to a small group, buddy. 6 years old. He's like, I've already got my kids' names picked out. And I have several candidates for my wife, too. So I like that, Tatum. Future thinking. We got a problem there. But it's important. It's important, I think, for you to know that we are not just building a building. We're building a home. It's the difference between... And some of you have experienced this, and some of you will experience it soon. It's the difference between renting and owning. Will said, amen. It's the difference. And I'm not throwing any shame on anyone who rents or anything. That's not what this is about. But you know the difference. That when this is mine, and I can do whatever to it I want. And one day, your kids are going to pass by a building with their kids in the car. And they're going to say, that's where we go to church. Or if they're off, they moved off. I pray that we create an environment where they always want to come back. And we're not another church that hurts a whole generation of people. And they can drive by this building and say, that's where I grew up in church. And those people are the real deal. You can say whatever you want to about them, but they're the real deal. And I'm just, man, I'm so stirred about everything. I think that next year, I told Katie this, and who knows, we'll see. Especially if we go over our number that we have. You know, the church is pledging, right? The church as a whole. So we have the generosity campaign that the church is going to be giving into. And that's where the majority of our giving is going to go. And anything above that, we're going to throw it at it. And we're going to try to get this building built as quick as possible. So that instead of, and this is where it becomes important to catch vision. To know that what's coming later is going to be exponentially more than what's now. Instead of giving away 70 baskets, we're giving away 100,000 pounds of food. That's the difference. And we can give away 70 baskets every year for the rest of our church, but it's not enough. And the reason why it's not enough is because there's still people hungry. There's still people signing up. There's people that, like, email me all the time, are y'all doing anything for Christmas? There's needs to be met, and we're called to meet them. And so, last but not least, the William, man of God, tell us a little bit about why you're here, why your family's here, what this church means to you, and just why you guys are pledging to give.
So, a little backstory on myself and my family. We moved to Knoxville to help actually plant this church. Day one, A1 kind of thing. I mean, like, boots on the ground. Since the beginning, we felt stirred and called, obviously, to the area for multiple reasons, not just church, but family was closer. And where we were at, I actually grew up there, but my wife did not. There was a community, but there was just something missing there for, especially for her. She just didn't feel the connection there. And so we both prayed about it. And at the time, Pastor Casey brought the idea up for us to help plant the church. And it was like that window, like, we didn't even bat an eye. We said yes, like, almost immediately, because we knew, like, that was the next step God was calling us to. And so fast forward, I've been here since the beginning. I've seen this church morph into, you know, from where it was to where it is now. It was great then. It's great now. But along the way, I've actually been able to grow in an area of my life that makes this, what we're doing as a church, very personal. I've been able to see God move in my finances, like, blow your mind. Like, crazy, crazy stuff. Basically, me and Timmy are kind of like on the same path as far as what God's done in our lives financially. And I never grew up, you know, I was never taught any of this that has to do with finances. I've been in church I would say most of my life. And I have been taught biblical principles, but the side of it that the church kind of leaves out a lot of times where you don't get mentorship is actually how to handle your money. And so when Cole brought the idea up of the Build It campaign, it was the first time that I was in a position to be able to take it personal. And the reason why, like, it stirs me up so much to be able to do this is, like, 5 years ago, I had, at the time, I just had two kids. Millie wasn't born yet. Mary was kind of in between working, and I worked I waited tables while I served at the church, like, relentlessly, like, all the time. And I kept praying that same prayer that we pray every Sunday. And the reason why it's personal to me is because when I moved here, I put my money where my mouth was, and I sold, like, half of my music gear. And I'm a musician. That's why I came here, is to help with the worship team mainly. And so I sold all that, and I sold it as, like, God, I'm trusting you. Like, this is the right step for us and our family to be here. And we always, like, if you ask Mary, like, we always faithfully tithe and gave. If we had $30 to give in tithe, or we had $100, or, you know, I sold all my stuff, and it's like, okay, well, we're going to pay our bills and then figure out how to tithe between all this. And, you know, the principles that I applied here at this church, that he gives us the power to get wealth.
Yeah.
Like, I've seen that happen in my life. Like, you wouldn't believe. And this is the first time that I can stand here and say that whether you give $5, $1,500, $10,000, it doesn't matter. But for the first time in my life, I'm in a position to, like, legit impact people with my finances. And this church is giving us a platform to do that.
It's good.
I've been able to, like, God's blessed me in ways that, I mean, it just, like, I could never turn my back on God at this point, because there's just so much in the finances that God's blessed me with, and he's allowed me to do that, I know, because of a couple different things. And what I really wanted to do is stir you guys up to possibly pursue this as we start this build campaign. And the first thing that I want to charge you guys to do is to be, one, to be intentional about your money while we're doing this, while we're building.
It's good.
Because, I mean, you can, like, Brandon McAlpine was talking this morning. Like, they were looking at their finances, and they found something going on to where, like, because they were intentional, they found the money that they were supposed to be giving towards this campaign within that. If you pay attention to your money and you're very serious about it, not in a greedy way, but a way that honors God, this is the mindset shift that I've had that's helped me get to the place where I'm at now, to be able to take this personal. And that's what I want to charge you guys is, one, take your money serious and personal, because the more that you show God that you're intentional about your money, the more that he will give seed to the sower.
It's good.
And it's good. I've seen that in my own life. And this is not a brag. I don't care if anybody comes and talks to me about this afterwards, because this is what God's done in my life. And literally, and this is my fourth year working my job that I'm at now, or fifth year, I've been able to 6 times my income. And I really 5 times my income from 4 years ago. I did that in 2 years. And why? It's because we sat there, and whenever I didn't have any money, I didn't have, you know, I had 2 kids, a wife that stayed home, and I'm working the grind every day trying to make sure that we can keep the lights on and that this, you know, we're still able to give and serve at this church. What do? We sowed that seed. We showed God that we were intentional about our money, and we've always been that way. And I believe that's one of the reasons why God's allowed increase in my life to be able to get to this point to be impactful in people's lives.
It's good.
And I think that this, for a lot of people in this room right now, is a platform for you to start doing that. This is a catalyst for people to see increase in their finances, not because you want to get rich. I can literally connect you with people that would give you step-by-step exactly how to make a lot of money. That's not the point. The point is God, how much can you grow me so I can grow the impact that I have on my community and my church? And so that was the first thing that God really, he started, like, when I started making just a little bit more money than I was, it was like a light switch went off. He's like, you better get serious about this, because if you don't, then even the little habits that you had before, they're going to come in and they're going to take away your seed. That's what it is. Money is not, it's not yours.
It's good.
It's not yours.
It's good, man.
It's literally, that's the thing. Is like, you have to, like, this Build It campaign is going to just like shift people's vision on money and God and how God really wants to use it in your life, bring it. I literally texted my wife. She asked me something about, we had to tithe off of something else that I had going on, and I said, money comes and money goes. 5 years ago, it'd be, oh, my God, I forgot about that. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's a difference in that mindset already. But guess what? God wants you to get to the point. He wants everybody in this room to get to the point where your money comes and money goes.
It's good, man.
No sweat. You want to know why? Because I know that I prayed that prayer 5 years ago, and I'm still praying it now, that you give me the power to get wealth.
It's good, man.
And so with this Build It campaign, I mean, like, this is the time for all of us to say, you know what? You know, I've served in ministry, if you have, to a capacity, or God, you know, I've been faithful as a believer, or you know what? I just, like, everybody's in a different season of their life. They've done different things for God, but this is where you can take it personal and really say, God, I will be the hands and feet.
Yeah.
I will sow into something that's bigger than myself, that can impact a community the right way. I mean, I've been a part of churches, literally. I'm not throwing names, not doing anything, but I've been a part of churches that are five times the size, and the giving is 1/6. I've seen the numbers. I know the numbers. So you're talking about a church that's six times less than another church that I've been a part of, and we give six times more. Why? Because yeah. God has anointed this place to be hands and feet. Like, literally since day one, it's been, hey, we're not just, this is just not going to be a place to where you can just, like, get the oil thrown on you and the hands laid on you, which is great. I'm kind of all about that stuff, too. But it's a place to where you can, like, the practical things of the gospel can happen.
That's good, man.
And it all starts, it's starting now with this Build It campaign. And so this church has been huge in my family. It's been a catalyst, a place that you know that we can lean on to pray that prayer whenever you got $1,000 in your bank account, your rent's $900, and you're not getting paid for a while. Like, that's not good to be in that position. But this church has been a place from the beginning when we were broke, and now the place that we're at, we're able to impact more people, and this church was a part of it the whole time. So, like, there's no bigger honor than to invest. That's what you're doing.
Yeah.
You're investing. And that's another thing that I want to put on you guys, is to start looking at money as a way to invest to grow it, not so you can make more money, because that's the easy part. But the big thing is like, if you start to get into investing, and not just from a practical standpoint, from a spiritual standpoint, if you look in the Bible, there's so many times where the investment was so small. It was so little. But what happened every time? God blessed it. He grew it. And then, so what God's trying to do in this church is through this Built It campaign, he's asking us, can I just take you on a journey?
Yeah.
Of investment.
It's good,
and
man.
It's not investing money to just see a building. It's God, what can you do with $1,500, and how much can you grow it?
Yeah.
How much can you take $100? What can you do with that? Yes, I trust you. That's what this Build It campaign is about, and that's why I'm so pumped about it, is because I've been on the journey. I'm still on the journey. I feel like I got a grace and an anointing in my life to pursue like this money side that I never had 5 years ago, 6 years ago. But why I'm so pumped about it is this right here, what we're doing at this church, is the real deal.
Yeah.
This church is the real deal. I've been to plenty of churches that, I mean, I, you guys don't know my backstory, but I've been ministry since I was 12 years old. Somehow, some way, I don't know why, but and I've been to, I cannot tell you how many churches. And this one is, there's something so genuine about impacting the community, not just through the normal church stuff, but the stuff that we've all been longing for. We want to see people legitimately changed.
Yeah.
Would you guys want to see somebody walk in and say, you know, I'm a single mom, I've got three kids, and my car's busted? Okay, fine, let's go buy you another one.
That's right.
Who wants to be a part of that?
That's right. That's right.
And so this is the start of that kind of stuff. Have you guys ever seen Mr. Beast on YouTube? There's a bunch of young people in here. Young, oh my God. I'm 34. But you see how like crazy? I watched an episode with my daughter yesterday. But he's able to give astronomical amount of money to people. Why is it that he's the one doing that? Why are we not able to do that? Why? It's because we have something in the way. It's debt. We need to remove that out of the way and take it personal. So that's what I want to charge to you guys, is like to take this personal. It's not just a church asking for money. This is a seed to sow that literally, if you want to be the hands and feet of Jesus and you want to be a part of something that's bigger than yourself, this is it right here.
It's awesome. Yeah. It's awesome. And he's serious, too. Like, he's serious. One of my favorite, I tell stories about people in our church, all good stories, when I get to travel and preach. And one of my favorite stories about generosity actually is Will's. And he actually told me one time, and I'll never forget this, that they were kind of in a tight spot. And he just talked about selling all of his music equipment, but he had other music equipment still with him here. And I need to emphasize this. If you're not a musician, there's no way to understand how important their equipment is to them. They would rather have their equipment than a house. Like, yeah, I mean, it's like they would. They would rather have their equipment than a car, because we can come pick you up to play that guitar, but that guitar don't make that noise that you make with that guitar. But one of my favorite stories is that, and I hope you're fine with me sharing this, but we're about to find out. Yeah. We'll know after or not. One of my favorite stories is Will has a very nice piece of equipment. A very nice piece of equipment, and they were short money, and he was like, I'm going to sell this so that we can give. Now, I want you to think about this. I want you to compare this. Go out there and look at your car and say, I'm going to sell that so that I can give. Same thing. It's the same thing. It's that important. Listen, something about me, you should probably just know this. I do not put people on this stage to talk about this that aren't generous. I'm not that dude. Like, I'm not going to have people up here telling you to give that don't give. I'm not going to tell you to give if I don't give. And I've had people come up to me before and they want to know why that we place such an emphasis on money at this church. I make no apologies about that. Jesus talked about money 42% of the time. So why do we put a lot of emphasis on it? I guess because we follow Jesus, right? I'm not afraid to say things, and we are not afraid to say things about money as a church. We're not afraid to do that. There are churches all over the country that will never preach on money because of whatever reasons. They're either afraid to, they don't want a lot of people to leave their church, and I want to be faithful to following Jesus. And generosity is a way of Jesus. You know, on our wall out there, Ways of Life, we give generously. We do not put that on the wall as like a wish. It's who we are. It's a part of who we are. And I could go on and on and on and on and on. Will said something, and then we're gonna give our Build It offering right after this, Jansen, and you can come back on up. Will said something about going on this journey with God about giving. The miracle, and I've said this in one of my sermons, the miracle that God will do, not in giving us a building, the miracle that God will do over the course of these 3 years, if you commit to faithfully giving and tithe and offering, and faithfully giving your pledge, is that he will pluck greed out of your heart. He will take all of that selfishness and pluck it out of your heart. That's the miracle that he will do if you are faithful in doing that. There's never been a time that it's more important, I think, especially with the economy the way that it is. There's never been, okay, let me say this so that I don't get off on the economy. The worst thing that you can do in an economic crisis where things are beginning to cost more and people are having less, the worst thing that you can do is stop giving. Because all it's going to do, all our economy is set up to do, is to make you want more. Giving puts your money in its place, and it puts your heart in its place. And it says, I'm content with what I have. Let me tell you something you may not know about Will. Will and Mary, they cook dinner every night. They don't go out to eat. Hardly ever. You want to talk about good stewards? They make way more money than me. Way more. And Will's in there throwing down every night in the kitchen. It's good too, son. It's good. But it's like, why? Because they're content. They're content. Now me, God's still working that out in my heart. But I'll get there. Katie says that she's just not content. But Katie is generous. Katie and Joe are generous. I want you to think about this. I want you to think about what you've heard. And I want to leave you with this thought, and then we're going to all give our Build It offering together, and I'm going to pray over it. God, in all of this, I feel like, and I've had this sense since I started preaching this series, is pleased with what's happening here. There are acts of justice that God is pleased with. And there's acts of injustice that God is not pleased with. And God forbid we be another church on the block that is here for status and not for service. God forbid. There's enough of those. I want to be able to say, I don't want to be the church that takes in millions of dollars a year and gives away 4% of our income. I don't want to be that church. You know why we give away 20% of our income now? Because that's what we'll do when we have a lot more money coming in. Can I get more real with you? Can I just be open and honest with you? You know the reason why that our staff here, we make a fair, livable wage, but we will never be paid in excess because we're not here for status. Every one of us could go make more money somewhere else doing something else. Every single one of us. We're here for service. We're here to touch the world around us. Giving is the largest budgeted item in our operations budget. Giving. And it'll always be that way. And one day when we're out of debt, I'm telling you, mark my words when I say this. Mark my words when I say this. You can take me at my word on this. When the income is there and we are out of debt, we will give away more money than we operate on at this church fully. Mark my words. So if it costs us $25,000 to operate this church per month, we'll give $30,000 away. And I'm dead serious about that. I want to be that uncommon. I want to be that different. I do not want to have 800 staff at a church that doesn't need 800 staff. Will we have to hire more staff at some point? Of course. You know how many? It's probably going to take a staff member when we're giving away 100,000 pounds of food a week. That'll constitute for that. But I hope you're stirred. And I hope you are encouraged. And I hope that you know that you can trust us to do what is right with what you give. I hope you know that. We have people in place to do that. Most churches, this is the honest to God truth. I was at breakfast telling Nick and Seth this yesterday. But most churches, this is the honest to God truth, they put boards in place not to make decisions, but to support their decision. At this church, our board, there are 8 different people that can at any moment say, I want to see where all the money's going. 8 different people at any moment. And 2 of the people on our board, they are in a church that has millions of dollars in the bank, debt-free, and they impact their community. And they're on our board for that reason. That's why they're there. All right, let's stand together. This is a really, really cool moment. There's a couple different things that you can do here. If you're texting to give, this is how you need to text to give for this. You need to put the dollar amount that you're going to give in the Build It offering, and that it needs to have Build It behind it. If you do not do that, it will go to our normal tithe and offering. Okay? I need it to be marked clear so that we can see what we've taken in for this. If you are filling out a check, it needs to say Build It on it. If you're giving on the Church Center app, there is a tab that literally says Build It. It says Tithes and Offerings, Build It, and Merch. Click on the Build It one when you give in this offering. And then if you're giving online, it should be the same thing. Just make sure that you click on Build It. But let's pray together about this morning. Let's take a moment and thank God for this. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to give today. We thank you for the opportunity to put this seed in the ground. Lord, I thank you for what you're doing. Lord, we're believing you this morning for $50,000 in this offering. We want to kick this thing off right. We want to do this right. We want to build this building. Lord, I pray that every seed that gets sown into the ground in this offering, Lord, I pray that you would multiply it. I pray that you would give people opportunities, professional opportunities that would blow their minds. You would give them pay increases. You would give them bonuses. You would give them surprise checks in the mail. People would call and pay off debt for them. Lord, I pray that you would do something miraculous in this offering in their lives as it pertains to finances. Lord, this is our build it offering. We are building a house for the next generation. We are building a house for you. We are building a house for those people who need rest for their soul. And Lord, we are thankful to be here this morning and have this opportunity. You've put us here for this time. It's not by coincidence that you have brought this group of people together and given us this vision. We know it's from you. And here is us literally putting our money where our mouth is. This is us doing that this morning. Lord, we love you today. God bless this. In Jesus' name, amen. Here's a little bit more instruction. If you need to drop off your packet, be sure that you drop off your packet before you go today. If you have a check, Katie and Emily are going to be in the back. Or if you have cash, you can give it that way too. They're going to be in the back with a bucket back there. Be sure that you drop your Build It offering in that bucket and drop your pledge in the basket out front. And I love you guys, and I will see you next week. It's going to be a really fun sermon. And be sure that you invite people to our Christmas service this year, which is happening on December the 17th. It'll be a normal Sunday morning service, but it's going to be really powerful and really cool. So I love you guys so much. Thank you for giving today, and I will see you next week. Hey, what's up, everybody? It's Pastor Cole here. Thank you so much for watching today. Our challenge to you is that you would now join us in person. You can go on our website right now to plan your visit to Resting Place Church. We love you, and we hope to see you soon.